Hello, everybody. Thank you to invite me here. It's very nice to visit Boulder and this new community I didn't know until now. So we heard a lot about the ROMs, and now I'm going to present the Telemark system. I started my work when I was a student and a postdoc at in the States a long time ago. So I was studying small-scale sediment transport processes, and now I go to large-scale applications. So I'm mainly in charge of the development of the sediment transport modules in the Telemark system. So the Telemark system is now open source. It's a finite element, a free surface model, and it's made of many components. So for free surface flow hydrodynamics, we have a Telemark 2D, which is a 2D flow component, and the 3D component is a Telemark 3D. We have sediment transport. For the 2D, it's a CZIF, and 3D is a CD 3D. It's actually part of Telemark 3D. It can be also coupled to DELWAC, which is from DELP 3D. And for the waves, we have TomaWAC, or large-scale applications, and Artemis for smaller-scale models. So this, the other things we need is also a grid generator, which we recommend to use BlueCanoe, which is a new, recently developed model. And the heart of this model, of the different modules, are the finite elements library. It's called BIEF, and you need also some post-processors like FUDA and Paraview. So I would say that this the whole set of this system requires most of the, satisfies most of the requirements that James told us about on Friday. So it's in Fortran 90. It's written in Fortran 90, and all the modules are well documented, and I hope they do what they are expected to do. And we had the, so it's been open source for a year now, so since July 2010. We have a users club every year, so last one was in October, so a week ago actually, and we had 130 participants, so a crowd about this size. And we have 2,000 people registered in the world and in more than 100 countries. I'm not sure they are all using it, but actually they downloaded the code. For the developments are shared and the organized, and also the strategy of developments are decided by a steering committee. And it's mainly a European committee where we have three institutes, three French institutes. I don't know if I can use this. So SOGREA, and CETMEF, and EDF. And we have two English ones, HR Wallingford and Darrisbury. And this is a German one, BAW. Okay. Next one. So it's a multiple scale. Of course, we go to from small scale to large scale applications, and so multi-physics. So we need to couple the models, the hydraulic models and the sediment transport or the water quality or the wave modules. So the way to do that, we have different options. We can chain the models. That's the older way it was doing. We used to do that a long time ago. And the most efficient way is to internally couple the models. So it means, for example, if you couple Telemark 2D or 3D with CZIF, actually CZIF is like a subroutine of the main hydraulic module. And now we have a new internal coupling also for the Telemark 2D and Tomahawk. And this allows us, for example, to simulate the longshore transport, the longshore wave-induced current. And for the long-short transport, we still need the coupling with CZIF. And we will have this probably at the end of, well, for the next version. So the other way to do it is also use an external platform. And it's been done by HR Wallingford. They coupled the different modules using OpenMI. I think you can do something similar at CSDMS. Okay, so what is important also is parallelism. So all the options are parallel, and we use MPI. And we also include this includes all the options, and we have different options for the advection terms, for to treat the advection terms. And this also includes the method of characteristics. I think it's a very difficult point. It's been tested with up to a grid with 1 million of points, and you can use up to 1,024. I think they do more now, but it's been tested at this time up to 1,024 processors on IBM BlueJean. Well, yes, it's tested up to 8,096 processors, sorry. And okay, so this is the results of that. So if you are along the red curve, it's ideal speed up, but somehow we start to diverge and have a lower to lose. It's less efficient if you're using above 4,000 processors. So as I said, it's applicable to very different situations, from rivers, estuaries, and also littoral applications. Here's an example of sediment transport in estuaries. It's in England. And this is an interesting problem, very important for EDF. It's a salinity intrusion. It's in the Bear Lagoon. So you can see on the in the red, it's the Mediterranean. High salinity coming into this freshwater freshwater lagoon, and you need a very refined grid at the level of the stratification. A nice example is also the propagation of tsunami, and we try to reproduce 26 December. It was in 2008. Can't read. It was in Sri Lanka, actually. And we can also have application in the ocean, and this is a wave and tidal combined coupling for the Atlantic Ocean's ocean model. So the BF library is the heart of the whole model. So it's been basically written by Jean-Michel Hervouet, and he wrote a book, so you can find all the information on this. I'm not going to give you course on finite elements, but you have equivalence between finite elements and finite volumes, depending how you define the cells of integration. So, well, you don't need to know everything about finite elements to use the models and even to model, I mean, even to program new processes. Because all the fundamental operations on matrix, vectors, and scalars are already built in this BF library. An important thing is all implicit schemes, and it's interesting because it allows us to have current numbers up to 10. So it's nice to speed up the calculations and to have to go to large scale and large scale and long-term morphodynamics. So we use the Perl scripts and its MPI for the parallelism. Okay, we had a talk before. You presented briefly the difference between 2D and 3D models. So I try to put this on the same slide. I hope it's not too confusing. So if you have 2D models, your main variable are the depths integrated velocity and water depths, and you want to use a 3D model, you're going to have insight in the flow on the vertical structure, and also calculate the vertical velocity. So it's much more precise, much more expensive too. So for in order to use a 2D model, it's generally valid if you have water depths less than the horizontal scales, and you can assume hydrostatic pressure, and it's applicable to non-recirculating and well-mixed flow. So no stratification. For the 3D model, you need you have two versions, one for hydrostatic pressure and the other one non-hydrostatic pressure. So if you have a strong recirculating vertical flows, you have to use a non-hydrostatic pressure. And you need a turbulent flow model, so that's important. So the equations for the 2D model are the shallow water Samenon equations, depth integrated equations, and so you have the continuity first equation, and the second one is a momentum equation. I don't know if I can use that one. Yeah. So the and in this momentum equation, the important term is the bottom friction. I already presented it because it's very important for a sediment transport application to have a good representation of this bottom friction. So in a 2D model, you have a quadratic friction law. It means that the bed shear stress is related to the depth average flow velocity. And generally, the physical, you have different friction laws and different friction law coefficients, but the most physical one, I mean, is the one which relates the quadratic friction coefficient to this bed roughness. So bed roughness is a classical relation when generally the velocity in most situations can be in boundary layer problem, it can be represented by a log profile. And in the 2D approach, we assume the log profile to be valid up to the free surface. So in the 3D model, we solve the full Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equation, where here you have the turbulence coming in, turbulence term, and you need a turbulence model for that to determine this term. And the difference between the 2D and the 3D is also in the representation of the bed friction, so it enters the boundary conditions of the 3D model. And you don't need to assume anymore a log profile up to the surface, but you have to do this assumption at the first elevation plan. So the bed friction is now related to the bottom velocity. So this is people who are working on, who are responsible of this 2D model. This is Chitwan, who is responsible of the 3D model. So you can contact them if you decide to use the models. So other things to say. So the 2D model is basically the most robust and efficient model, and you can apply it to large scale and long-term long-term applications. The 3D model is more precise, more accurate, very interesting, and you can get some very detailed results on the structure, vertical structure. But it's highly sensitive to the choice of turbulence model. So you can go to the K epsilon 2 equation model or use a mixing length turbulence model. It's also highly sensitive to the vertical grid resolution and the way you're going to set up your plan, vertical plans. So you need to do a lot of tests and to be very careful when you use this model. One important feature common to both models is the treatment of dry zones on tidal flats, for example. So there is no element removal. All points are treated, even if they are dry. Yeah. And generally just take the, well, you just if you have a dry element, you just get rid of the free surface gradient, you set it to zero. But there is a new recently developed algorithm, which is considered to be the best because it's mass conservative and it's also positive. It ensures the positivity of water depths. So you can find details in this paper. So an example of application is a classical for us. It's a terrible event. It was in December 1959. We had the break of this large dam, Malpasset dam break, and it's located in the south part of France. Well, it's about 10 kilometers from the Mediterranean Sea. So it was a very sudden and unexpected break of this dam, and it was, I think, 220 meters long and 60 meters high, and we had the release of 50 million of 50 million of water flew into the valley. It was very quick. So we use a grid mesh of about 26,000 elements and time step of 4 seconds. And the length of the simulation is 1,000 time steps. So it's about 1 hour. And you can see that right at the start, after 60 seconds, the velocity is just at the very narrow part, I mean, at the level of the dam, are very large, like 10 meters per second. So, this is an animation. No? I don't know if I can... Well, it is an animation. You can see you cannot see it, but I don't know why. Anyways, you can see you should be able to see the wave going down really quickly, and it's all dry zones, so it's very important to have this nice treatment of the dry zones. And you have a comparison validation with comparison with maximum elevation, water elevation, and as a distance from the dam. And an example of the CPU time. So if you use one processor, it's only 52 seconds. And if you go to 8 processors, it's only 10 seconds. Now you can do the same thing with a 3D model, but you will have, even if you only have 2 planes, it's equivalent to a 2D model, actually, but you multiply by 3 the CPU time. Okay, just a word on the wave generation model called Tomahawk. So it's a third generation spectral wave model. So the main variable is the variance density directional spectrum. And it's solving the conservation of the wave action. So it includes shoaling, refraction, nonlinear interactions, and for the source term, it's wind generation, and the sink is wave dissipation due to breaking, white capping, and bottom friction. We now have the wave current interaction for littoral applications, littoral currents, taking into account radiation stresses. This is put back into the calculated by Tomahawk and going into the Telemach model, and can be applied to oceanic or coastal zones. And the person responsible is Giovanni Mattarolo. So this is an example of application. It's we wanted to have represent the wave propagation during a storm along the coast of France. So we have two nested models. One is the oceanic model with a very large grid and a much more precise coastal model. So the large scale model give the boundary conditions to the coastal model. And this is just a validation and with comparison at different harbor on the measurements between measurements and the model and model results for the wave height, time period, and direction. So we can see it's very good. And this is for the CPU time. So it's a bit more expensive and takes about, the minimum is using 20 processors and more than 1 hour for 1 year of simulation with on the oceanic wave model. Okay, now I go to sediment transport, so that's more I'm familiar with. So this is how we sketch the problem. We have basically the flow acting on the mobile bed, and the water depth is split in two zones. The near bed, very thin layer, you have a bed load. And in the upper water column, you have sediment transported as a passive scalar and suspended load. So it's quite a classical way to split the transport rate into bed load and suspended load. So for the bed load, we have a choice of formula to calculate. Well, they are semi-empirical and they come from the literature. One of the most, we have a choice of 10. And among them, some classical ones like Van Rijn, like Meyer-Peter. And the bed load transport rate is related to the excess bed shear stress minus critical bed shear stress. So once you derive the bed load transport rate, you solve the Exner equation, finite elements. So here is the bed porosity. This is a elevation due to bed load. And now we have two ways to, so this is done in Sisyphe, bed load. But if you want to solve the suspended load, you can, of course, use a total load transport formula, but it's not probably recommended if you have a variation in the flow. It's only if you have a steady state formula. So you need to solve this advection transport diffusion equation for the depth averaged sediment concentration. And if you go to the 3D model, you solve the full 3D equation and you have this additional, so you have advection and settling term take into account and turbulent diffusion here. This is only a horizontal diffusion. Once you work out, well, this is important, but I'll go back to that. It's erosion and source and sink terms coming from the bed, erosion minus deposition rate. And once you work out this concentration, you know what the erosion and deposition is, and you can solve the evolution due to suspended load. Well, the difficulty here is that, I'll go back to that, but the deposition and erosion and deposition rate need to be defined at a reference elevation, which is at the limit between bed load and suspended load. So we work on that, we are with Pablo, who's now responsible of Sisyphe, and myself, I'm here. Okay, we have different erosion and deposition law, depending if you have non-cohesive, coarser grain, and cohesive, very fine sediments. So if you are in the coarse grain, generally you have also to take into account sand grading effect. So you represent your grain by a finite number of grain sizes, each represented by its diameter and by also its percent, its availability in the bed. For each of the fraction, you're going to solve the Exner equation, calculate the bed load, suspend load, and so they are more or less individually. You solve each of these fraction individually. So the equilibrium for the erosion rate, if you have non-cohesive sediments, you're going to use equilibrium concentration formula. So basically the erosion rate is proportional to the equilibrium concentration, and this is the settling velocity. You have a number of, a choice of formula. So this is a generally used Van Rijn formula, but you can also use Biker or Sisserman and Fraser. And they are all defined, I mean, each formula gives you also the depth of this reference elevation. So each formula is associated to this reference elevation. And so this term is explicit in the model equations, and this term is treated as an implicit term. So the deposition rate is proportional to the concentration times settling velocity, but all of this is taken at the reference elevation. Okay, if you have coercive sediments, you're going to have Krohn and Partenades erosion and deposition laws. So here the difficulty is at the critical erosion rate. Critical erosion rate here is going to depend on the structure of the bed due to consolidation. So we again, if we are dealing with coercive sediments, we have to have a consolidation model. So we are building that. It's in the new release in 6.1, and we have now solving the Gibson equation, which gives you the evolution, time evolution of the concentration due to consolidation. I'm not going to have time to go into details in that. So if you have non-cohesive sediments, you need also to have a vertical structure of the bed due if you want to take into account these sand grading effects. So all of this, my plot here is not correct. This is here. This is the active layer. So the composition of the transport is related to the composition of this top layer, which is called the active layer. And you need to prescribe the active layer thickness in the model. So it's one of the limitations of this kind of approach. So basically, I could say many things about the differences and detailed, which are important when you want to simulate the transport. So here's an example of the difficulty you have. If you have a 2D model, you have to, in this transport term, the advection term for the concentration, it's actually the depth, it's a flux. It's a depth integrated concentration times velocity. But you only know what the mean concentration and mean flow velocity is. And you make a mistake if you just say it's mean concentration times the, if you don't times the depth average velocity, just because you have a vertical structure and most of the sediments, due to this very large gradients of the concentration, most of the sediments is transported near the bed where the velocity is smaller. So you have to take this vertical structure into account, and you can work out making some simple assumptions on the structure. This ratio between the convection velocity and the depth average velocity. So you can work out this term, and it's actually built in, you can find an analytical solution for this term, this alpha, and it's less than one. So it's important for this. So if you do a 3D model of the suspended load, then the problem is that you have the bed for the flow velocity is at the bed. But the suspension stops above the bed at the reference elevation. So how are you going to do that? And the suspension concepts break down if you extrapolate things down to the bed, mainly because the concentration becomes infinite. And so the settling term is infinite, and the erosion rate product of viscosity, zero, times concentration gradient is undefined. So we are trying different ways to, it's a tricky problem, we're trying different ways to deal with that. And one of them is to add a fictitious vertical plan where you define the boundary conditions and you stop the simulation. The other important thing that's highly sensitive, I mean the results are highly sensitive, more even than for the hydrodynamics, it's highly sensitive to the choice of turbulence model and the vertical grid resolution near the bed. One other trick, I mean you can do also if you do the 3D model, is to add a laminar diffusivity. So this is a Rouse profile, but it's modified if you have this finite laminar, well-defined constant laminar diffusivity. You add this into this. Well, I know I'm not sure you're all familiar with Rouse profile, but it's basically an equilibrium between settling and diffusion, vertical diffusion. But if you add a laminar diffusivity into this problem, you get actually finite values of this bottom near bed concentration. So the value of the laminar diffusivity, it shouldn't be important in the turbulent flow, is important here in this turbulence way we set up the model. So this is just a perfect way also to validate a 3D model. Log profile here, and concentration profile, comparison between concentration profile and the Totemax 2D are the crosses, and this is the analytical solution. So another typical validation test case for the 3D model is this Van Rijn experiment. It's been also used by other people. It's very classical. And he made some detailed measurements of the propagation of a trench and concentration and velocity profile at different vertical plans. So we use a 3D model with 16 vertical plans and non-hydrostatic pressure, and we get a really good agreement. I mean, depending on the, well, we tested different models, but basically we have a best agreement with the K, well, depending on which station, but you get sometimes better agreement with the K epsilon or the using the mixing length model. But overall, it works well. This is a bed evolution now. So you compare the 2D. So the 2D is really fast. I don't have the CPU time, but compared to the 3D model, it's way, way faster to use a 2D model. And okay, so here you see that the 2D model fails, I mean, goes too fast, whereas you get a good agreement with a 3D model. So in this case where you have this, well, kind of strong recirculation in the back of this trench, you need a 3D model. Well, you can see also the effect of this correction on the convection velocity, and it's slightly better, but not so, not quite good. Another example, you can use a 3D model to represent the flow pattern in a meandering or river complicated it's a river difference here. And this is a kind of thing related to what Jorge told us about. So you have a secondary recirculation, and this is a 3D model. And they are in the process of validating in comparison with ADCP measurements. Here is a Paraná River, so it's a collaboration with Carlos Yone. Another typical test case we are doing is this problem of meandering, and you have a deposit here and erosion on the outer edge. So you have some detailed measurements, and you can do the model in 2D, but you need to parameterize the secondary currents or their effect on the sediment transport. In 3D, you just need a good turbulence model. So if you use this parameterization, you get a fairly good agreement between the model and the measurements. Now, a nice application is ongoing work. It's a PhD, which is done at BAW by Annalena Gohl. So you can use a 3D model. Now you need a 3D model, very detailed, to get this bed forms formation and how the 3D model is going to reproduce these bed formations. So it's a very detailed model. It's a very small grid. And you need this. They also perform some experiments on the on this formation. So I go very fast. It's very neat. So here you have a results of the model animation. And you can see starting from a flat bed, you start to have a initial perturbation, and you have the build-up of these dunes kind of feature. And it's kind of realistic and very nice. But the problem is you get really different results depending on the number of the way you set up your grid. Basically, you need a very fine grid and number of layers good enough in order to represent to have realistic dimensions of the dunes. So that's ongoing work, so I'm not going to say much about it. Really, another, so this is if you have a 3D model, very detailed, you can go to represent the bed formation, the dune formation in your model. But if you use a 2D model, you're going to average these bed forms and their effect on the flow and on the sediment transport. So you need to parameterize the bed forms. So basically, you don't know how to do that. And another way is that here, generally, for the 2D model, the usual way is to use the bed roughness as a calibration parameter. But the alternative to do that is to have a predictor. So I'm going to say a word on that. So here we use a Van Ryn predictor. So it's based on Van Ryn 2007. And the bed roughness is decomposed into small scale, ripple roughness, medium scale, and dune roughness. And they all are a function of sediment parameters and flow velocity. So you can see that very small flow rate, you have the ripples, and then the dune is forming, and then all the bed forms are washed out. Yes. We have here an example of validation of these bed forms. I'll try to be short, but so it's just, it was the objective of this estuarine application of the coupling between Telemark 2D and Sisyph. It's done by Alan Davis at Bangor. So I'm just, won't have time to go into that. But basically, you can use this multi-beam bathymetry, very detailed, to work out what the scale of the bed forms are in this estuary. So we found we had some dunes at the deep entrance in the scour pit. And then he has ripples everywhere. And you could use the model and compare the model results here with the average dunes here. And this is a way to compare the two of them. And he found fairly good agreement. So it was a way to show that this approach is realistic. Bed roughness predictors is realistic. And it's also very important, not really for the flow. You cannot see very much difference. It is a comparison between the method of bed roughness predictor, and here is an imposed constant bed roughness. And you cannot see much difference on the flow velocity itself, but very large difference on the bed shear stress. It's a very strong effect, and even more so for the bed load transport rate. So I just go to the conclusion. We have this nice tool. You're welcome to use it. You can download it from the Open Telemark website or from the CSDMS website, and can be applied to very different complex environments. So we show a few applications from small-scale dune formation to large-scale, mesoscale, let's say, application, morphodynamics application. We have this problem of uncertainty in the results. There are lots of parameters in the models. One of them is very important, the bed roughness. So we showed that in order to reduce some uncertainty in the model results, we recommend to use this bed roughness predictor. And it's also a way to avoid some possible inconsistency between the model, hydrodynamics, and sediment transport models. So we are still building some more physical processes into the model. We have improving the sand grading algorithm. We want to have a more continuous approach. And we want to go to mixed sediments. We have the consolidation. And we are going to put the flocculation. We want also to go to mixed sediments. That's the main issue. Conclusion is that despite we have all our efforts, we still have a lot of uncertainty. And it's difficult to assess also what the uncertainty in the model, in the sediment transport models. And it's larger than for the hydrodynamic models. So we need a new validation test case. We need your help. And we also are working on this automatic differentiation of the code to get more qualitative information on this error we are doing. I can't finish this talk, but these are the main people, and they should be here to give this talk, actually. So Emile is the head of the project, and Jean-Michel is the father. He's been working on the development of the model since 1987. So thanks for your attention. It was a challenge to give you an overview of this big model. I think it's number one for the number of lines in CSDMS. It's rated number one. I don't know if it's a good sign or not. Do you have any questions?